means he has to have big things for you to bring it to... Is there anything that is impossible for God? No, I'm considering he's the one who has given me his word. He's the one who's given me his promises. He's the one that has to bring it to pass.
I love to see hungry hearts for Jesus. I remember a 25-year-old boy, young man. I had a hunger that came in me I couldn't explain for God, for the things. I grew up in a Pentecostal church. I grew up with a mother that loved Jesus with all of her heart. She prayed me out of the dungeon of hell, prayed me out of the works of Satan into the works of God. And such hunger came in me as this young businessman. I was in the piano and organ business. I had two mall stores and a warehouse store. And I would seek the Lord in the middle of the night, sometimes 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. Just go out. I had a little room for my children to play with their toys, 16 by about 40 long. Over it, and I remember going out there, and I would just start worshiping the Lord. And I remember nights the presence of God came in that room so strongly by myself that it was as though I could see the glory of the Lord. I couldn't explain it. And preachers would invite me because I'd meet them in the piano and organ business. They'd invite me to come share at their churches. Every now and then, I'd get a backslidden preacher and pray him through in my office. I mean, you know, sometimes a preacher can even backslide. Now, thank God we don't have that here. Thank God. And if he ever did, I'd come after him. And no, amen. But no, I have the highest respect for your pastor. But I'd pray him through sometimes. And often they'd invite me to come to the church and just share as a businessman. And every time I would do that, I didn't want to leave. It was that pastoral call in my heart, even back then. I didn't understand it. I didn't know what it was. But I would go and I wouldn't want to leave. I'd want to stay and wish I could teach. There's just an honor to being called to the ministry. You can't even take this call to yourself. No man takes this honor. The Bible calls it an honor to himself. It has to be the call of God. And wherever he calls, he equips. Whatever he's called you to do, he equips you to do. If he's called you to work fields on a tractor, he equips you to do it. When I was in the piano and organ business, God helped me. When I would go to sell product or demonstrate product, God helped me. He helps us in every area of our lives. You don't have to be a preacher to have the help and the anointing of God. This anointing abides in all of us. Can you say amen? So lift your beautiful hands to heaven and thank him for his anointing. Thank him for his power. Thank him for his glory. You know, I'm like the Apostle Paul. Since this is my last night, I can preach until daybreak, right? No, I'm just joking. You remember when Eutychus fell off the loft and went down and they had to go raise him from the dead? He had preached because he'd been long-winded. My son Josh, one time, one of the preachers, one of the guests that I would have in, one day Josh, he's just a little boy, he says, "I don't want to go to church tonight, Dad." Josh wasn't known as being the most spiritual. "I don't want to go to church tonight, Dad." I said, "Why, Josh?" He said, "Because he's long-breathed." So I really try not to be long-breathed, but we do want to get out tonight what the Spirit of the Lord wants to speak into this house. And I found out something about God. When he speaks a word, he wants to seed the word into a setting. And I'm always encouraged when he gives me a word when I go in a house. Sometimes he'll give you a general word for your traveling. I gave that last night because he had dealt with me. I want you to take this and minister it to the churches. But specifically tonight, he dealt with me about this. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles very quickly, book of Acts, chapter 3. And I'm going to talk on I believe in miracles. Why I believe in miracles. Hallelujah. I want you to say, I believe in miracles. I serve a miracle-working God. Hallelujah. Now, Peter and John went up together to the temple. This is verse 1. At the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. Now, I'm going to read quite a bit tonight. Is it okay? Actually, I'll read you so much you won't even have to read your Bible when you get home tonight. We're going because sometimes just some words up front from the Word, you know, the anointing's on the Word, in the Word. Can you say amen? And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. And fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, look at us. So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand, lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising the Lord. Don't you get nervous in a Pentecostal church. We're supposed to walk, to leap, and praise the Lord. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Just tell folks it's all right to walk, to leap, to praise the Lord. When I grew up, there was a little lady we called Sister Brookie. And in our Pentecostal church, it wasn't uncommon for them to hang from the chandeliers. I don't mean that literally. But then other times it would get as dead quiet as it did in here tonight, and we had a little wooden floor, and you could actually hear a pin drop. You could, if you'd have dropped a pin, it was that quiet, you could have heard it hit the floor. And so Sister Brookie was always full of the Holy Ghost. I mean, she was always full of the Holy Ghost. And you could even meet her downtown, and she'd come up, like she's always praying in tongues. She was just hilarious. And so, matter of fact, she'd come get a hold of me, shake me every now and then. She knew I needed what she had. So one time, I went with my grandparents to the Methodist church. They were having a revival. And Sister Brookie just decides to get happy. Now, in the Methodist church, this was a gorgeous Methodist church. It wasn't that big because it was a small community. Where I grew up was just 800 and some people. So it wasn't at all large, but it was a beautiful Methodist church with stained glass and white frame and pews. So Sister Brookie got happy. And she got up and started dancing on the pews of the Methodist church. Not a lot of wisdom, maybe, but a lot of spirit. And this preacher got up and he said, I will have none of that in this house. Now, what is Sister Brookie going to do? She just danced right on and danced right out the door and went home. Amen. But that woman loved Jesus as much as anybody I've ever met in my life. And everybody in the community loved her because when they would get in trouble spiritually, they'd go to her house and she'd pray them through. Precious woman of God. And even after she was getting ready to go to heaven, she'd had a stroke. She was lying in her bed. She could not verbalize words in English, but she would pray in tongues. She went to heaven praying in tongues. Praise God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
People like that were very precious. And so when I think about these scriptures about walking and leaping and praising the Lord, I think about some of the people I grew up around and what I saw out of their lives. And they were holy people. They lived right in the community. And even people that would talk about their extravagance in the spirit, they would say, but I'll tell you one thing, they live right.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. If you're going to walk and leap, live right. Yeah. Can you say amen? Yeah. Hallelujah. Come on now.
Yeah.
Peter and John were about to go into the temple. Look at us. Silver and gold I have none, but what I have I give you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. took him by the right hand, lifted him up, leaping, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising the Lord. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Now, if you had been bound and were lame and Jesus came by or one of his servants came by and made you whole, you would get up and walk and leap and praise the Lord. Can you say amen? Now, consequently, the religious people got really upset, like I was talking about last night. They didn't care that a miracle had happened. The man at the pool of Bethesda, they didn't care a miracle had happened. It was just that they had violated the Sabbath, and Jesus himself conveyed himself away, and they didn't like the fact that a miracle had been done on the Sabbath. They didn't care about the man getting a miracle. They cared more about their traditions. And here they are, the religious crowd, they're getting mad. Here's a man, lame from birth. He needed a miracle, and Peter starts to go by, and all of a sudden the Spirit quickened him, and he says, I don't have silver, I don't have gold, but I have something that I can give you. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And God made him whole from that moment, and he was praising the Lord. Now they're all mad about it. Because Peter stood up. He said, I want you to know something. This didn't happen by my goodness. That didn't happen by my righteousness. It's all because of the name that's above every name, the name of Jesus. And there is no other name given among men whereby we might be saved, but by the name of Jesus. Everybody who's trying to show you another way is a thief and a robber. There's only one way to heaven, and that is through the Son of the living God, and his name is Jesus. And we haven't even got started yet. Come on, give him praise. Just shake yourself tonight. Come on, just shake yourself. We're not bound. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. We're not bound up. We're free people whom the Son has set free. He's free. How many of you are free tonight? Are you free? I'm free. You free? I'm free. You free? I'm free. Touch somebody. Say, you free? I'm free. Hallelujah. Brother, you free? I'm free. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You know, there's just something about an atmosphere like this. It's like taking a rabbit and throwing him in a briar patch. He's perfectly at home. Hallelujah. I'm perfectly at home in this atmosphere. Praise God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So all of a sudden, they decided to explain themselves. Came to pass on the next day, this is chapter 4, that the rulers, elders, and scribes, as well as Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest, were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or what name have you done this? Now, I want you to notice this next phrase particularly. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost. I want you to say that. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost. Say it one more time. Filled with the Holy Ghost. One more time. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Said to them, rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to this helpless man, by what means he has been made well, let it be known to you all. And to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands before you whole. This is the stone. How many of you want to say Jesus is the stone? He is the foundation. Hallelujah. This is the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. We might be under shepherds to Jesus, but he's the great shepherd. You follow the great shepherd, and he gives under shepherds that work and hear his voice. But we follow the great shepherd. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Now notice, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we might be saved. Hallelujah. Why is that? Because no one else lived a perfect, sinless life, and was in a position to die for you and me. If there had been any impurity, if there had been anything that was not right, He could not have taken your place and my place, and yet he was just as dependent on the Holy Spirit on the earth as you and me are. Yes, he was the Son of God, 100% God, but he also was 100% man. And the Bible says he had temptations just like we do. He was in all points tempted just like we are, yet he never sinned. And this sinless, spotless Lamb went and took our place. Hallelujah. And one day we're everyone going to fall at his feet, and we're going to worship him and serve him. Can you say amen? Even when we get in his presence. Now, when they saw this boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained, they marveled. And they realized that they had been with Jesus. I want people to realize I've been with Jesus. How about you? And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. God sometimes does miracles that takes away all questions, all accusations. It's just something you can't explain. Now notice here. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, Peter and John, they conferred among themselves, saying, "What shall we do with these men? For indeed a notable miracle has been done through them is evident. And to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it." I'm telling you, I believe, and I'm not so futuristic that I'm always talking about the future. But I want to tell you something. The day's coming when there are going to be undeniable miracles. 25 years ago, I saw something in the Spirit that I will see. And I saw this. We were in church. At the time, the big church that we have now was not even built. And it never did. The other one didn't, even though it was round, it didn't quite look like it. But I thought, well, maybe this is it. But when we moved in a new building, I realized this is the building that I had seen so many years ago. And in this particular service, all of a sudden, the presence of God was so strong. I was actually about two-thirds in the back of the church just looking forward. And they had brought in a man. Actually, the ambulances had come down and brought them to the outside of the church in this vision now. And there was a man that had been brought in on a stretcher, emaciated in this vision. And all of a sudden, nobody touched him. Nobody put their hands on him. Just in the presence of God, they knew to lift him up, those ushers. And they lifted him up in that presence, and he was completely and immediately made whole. And let me tell you what's interesting about that. Did you know there were conventional ambulances and there were futuristic ambulances? And did you know when they weren't even talking about flying cars and all this stuff, I saw a future ambulance, a futuristic ambulance. What did it do? It had swivels in it, and it would take right off. It never went down the road like a conventional car. It went right up, and whoever was in it, it would just automatically adjust to them, and it was the most amazing thing you've ever seen. And I kept thinking, why were there conventional ambulances, and why were there futuristic ambulances? And one day it dawned on me, because before the conventional ambulances go and those start, God is going to start coming through in a marvelous way. Now, I know that's a far-out story, and I don't expect you to believe me, but let your heart listen. Yeah. Let your heart listen, because miracles are coming. The miracles of God are coming. God is going to do signs and wonders and miracles. Great and mighty things are coming, praise God. And I'm not just talking about what's coming, because he's here right now. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. There's no telling what he'll do right tonight. He is God Almighty. He is Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Alpha and Omega, hallelujah. The beginning and the ending. Hallelujah. He is Lord God Almighty.
That's right.
And he can do anything.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Young people. Oh, look at these young people. They're authentic. They don't want something that's not real.
Yes.
They want real. Yes. And I want to tell you something right now. We don't have to fabricate God. We just walk along with him. You can't do a miracle anyhow. You can't. I don't have 1 ounce of power on my own to perform a miracle. If I did, I'd go down to Lakeland Regional and clear it out. But I can only move as the Spirit leads me and touches me. And I've seen marvelous things in my ministry over the years, but I'm telling you right now, I had nothing to do with any of it. It's just you're in the right place at the right time, and God wants to do something, and he'll just take anybody that'll yield to him, and he'll use them for his glory. That includes you and you and you and you. He is a mighty God. Can you say amen? Well, I don't know how I got off on that, but I just can't help it. Listen to this. A notable miracle had been done, and they could not deny it. So it spread no further among the people. They severely threatened them, that from now on they speak to no man in this name. See, they were nervous about the name. You can go speak any name you want to, and nobody bothers you. But they won't let you speak in the name of Jesus. There's still threats about us using the name of Jesus. Why? Because they know. They know sometimes more than the church knows to be fearful of that name. Because that name transforms life. That name breaks the powers of darkness. That name does what no man can do. His name is wonderful. His name is Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, God of Glory. Hallelujah. The Lord God Almighty. So they called him and commanded him, don't you speak in the name. But Peter and John answered and said, whether it's right in the sight of God to listen to you more than God, you judge. For we cannot but speak, I like this now, the things which we have seen and heard. Sometimes you hear miracles. Sometimes you see them. Because if God is speaking, you're witnessing a miracle because he's a supernatural God. Can you say amen? Things we've seen and heard. You remember Philip went down to Samaria and preached Christ? They both seeing and hearing the miracles which he did, for unclean spirits went out of many. Hallelujah. You remember that story? It was beautiful. And it said, and great joy was in the city. Let me tell you, when Jesus comes to a city, there's great joy coming to that city. When he shows up, the devil has to get out of his way. Hallelujah. Because he died and rose again, victorious over death, hell, and the grave. The grave could not hold him. Hallelujah. He came up out of the grave. Can you say amen? Say with me. Come on. So when they threatened them, they let them go, finding no way of punishing them because of the people, since they all glorified God for what had been done. The people were rejoicing. The religious leaders were jealous. For the man was over 40 years old on whom this miracle of healing had been performed. Now notice, in being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard this, or the threats, they raised their voice to God, and I want you to pick up on this one thought for a moment, with one accord. You see, Satan will try to plant people in the house of the Lord. He will try to plant them to break the one accord. He'll try to do that.
Yes.
The enemy hates unity because there's power in unity. And if he can come in a church and he can just stir a little bit, they don't realize it, that they're being used of Satan, and that'll come back on them. You've got to watch out. I'm not being threatening tonight. I'm just saying we need to protect the unity of the house and be in one accord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. They raised their voices with one accord and said. Now, they said this all together. How many of you are reading your Bible right now? Let's say this together. Lord, you are God. Just come on along with me. Who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. Who by the mouth of your servant David has said, why did the nations rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate and the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness, hallelujah, I've noticed this. The more I pray and get filled, the more bold I become. Amen. There's something about the house. We need boldness in the house of the Lord. Can you say amen? Now notice. By stretching, they ask him to do something. give us boldness. How are they going to get that boldness? By stretching forth your hand to heal, that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken. Now notice again, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and spoke the word of God with boldness. It takes a filling and a refilling to speak boldness in the Lord. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Twice in this passage is the statement, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. Here's the thing. We could add they were refilled with the Spirit because they had already been filled. You think about it. God had promised to pour out of His Spirit. Jesus had come. He took His disciples. He sent them to Jerusalem. He said, I want you to go there. I want you to wait until you're endued with power from on high. Hallelujah. And all of a sudden, they were assembled in the upper room. And it said, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. One accord in one place. One accord. Say it with me. One accord in one place. And I noticed, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. It filled all the house where they were sitting, and hallelujah, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Do you know who gives you utterance? It's the Spirit. I have to tell you a real interesting story. And this didn't happen 100 years ago. This happened 2 months ago. One Sunday morning, a professor's wife teaches at Southeastern University, Dr. Golden. He's a wonderful man. I have him preach at my church along. Great man of God. They were in church, and she came up for prayer. She had a physical something. She needed to come pray for it. And I just had the sense praying tongues over her. So I just stopped, put my hand on her, prayed in tongues over her. That was the end of it as far as I knew. Dr. Golden calls me in the afternoon at my home. He says, Pastor Reggie, I've got to tell you something. He said, when my wife, his wife's Hispanic, he said, when she came down this morning for prayer, you prayed over her in perfect Spanish. You used the name of Jesus and the blood of Jesus, hallelujah, and prayed over her, the anointing of God, and said, and then you ended up in Latin. I'm not talking about something 100 years ago. I mean, I could tell you about going to Peru. I was up one night, up about 4 feet in the air on this big, and the building was filled with people, and the Spirit of God was falling, and all of a sudden I was led of the Spirit to go down, and all of a sudden I saw this Catholic priest, and I walk up to him, not knowing what I'm going to say to him, and I begin to speak to him in his own language. Hallelujah. I tell you, this thing's real. It's real. David, come on, it's real. It's real. Come on, let's just sing that a minute. It's real. It's real, I know. It's real. It's Pentecostal blessing.
Pentecostal blessing. I know it's real.
Come on now, it's real.
It's real.
I know
it's real. This Pentecostal blessing. I know it's real.
Hallelujah. Can you say amen? You see, religionists hate what we have. They're cessationist. They don't believe miracles happen today. They will say, yes, God sent Pentecost. Historically, they believe in Pentecost. Yes, God did miracles. Historically, they believe in miracles. They believe an antiquated truth, but they will deny that He does miracles today. They worship a God who was, and yet deny the God who is. That's what religion does. It takes the joy out of serving God. It becomes arduous and difficult. And I'm telling you right now, praise God, when God comes on you, He frees you from bondages. He sets you up. He wants you to be happy, praise God, and blessed of the Lord, blessed coming out and blessed going out. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. For this is a day these things will increase, and the power of God will increase, and we will see the things we've heard about. They will be real to us, and we will rejoice in them and be glad. For this is the day of the Lord. This is the coming day of the Lord. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Shout out loud and say, I believe that.
I believe that.
Listen to this for a moment. To the cessationist, I would say, every time somebody who's unsaved comes to Jesus and he washes away their sins and he translates them out of the kingdom of darkness and moves them over into the kingdom of his dear son, that's a miracle. Every time somebody's sick in their body and diseased, and he comes in and he heals them, that's a miracle. Every time somebody's under the power of Satan and bound, I'm telling you, when he comes in, he's a miracle. My father-in-law was an example of that. He was literally a drunk. He'd lost his wife. Everything was going wrong. But one day he found Jesus, and the next day he wanted nothing else to drink. Hallelujah. He's cursed like a sailor, but he never said another curse word. Jesus came and made him whole. You may have somebody in your family, I don't know how they're ever going to turn out. They're going to turn out all right if you'll turn it around in the spirit. Hallelujah. That's why you've been given a tongue to pray ways you don't know how to pray and to bring things to pass that you don't know how to bring to pass, because he's going to pray through you secrets, mysteries, divine realities that you cannot know with your head. I don't know why I'm yelling. I just can't help it. You know, I'm supposed to yell today, but I'm yelling. Is it all right with you I yell? Yes. Just shout out, I'm not deaf. You're not nervous either. Hallelujah.
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 You've got me in trouble here. I'm just enjoying this. Hallelujah.
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 Now I want to share the miracle, the story. B and I, my wife, my beautiful wife, I heard a lady give a testimony we were amazed at. So in the subsequent years, we had this lady come to our church three different times. Gay, do you ever remember Betty Baxter coming to our church? Yeah. Miss Betty Baxter, she was one of the most precious people you've ever known. She loved Jesus with all of her heart. And what I'm going to tell you is a documented miracle. This isn't something fabricated. It's documented. She was born with a curvature in the spine that continued to get worse, to the point that when she was close to 12 years of age, she couldn't even look up. They had to set her in a chair way back so that she could see people who would come to see her. She had other organic diseases. She was in horrible shape and wasn't expected to live long. And finally, she wanted to go, at 12 years of age, she wanted to go down to a VBS school and just be a part of it as a little girl, and they had to take her in and do everything they could for her. But she had become bitter over time because of the fact that she was born this way and she couldn't go out and play with little kids like everybody else. And she felt cheated in life and she felt hurt. And she had never met Jesus because inside she kind of blamed him. First of all, we need to know every good gift, every perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness. If it's not good, it's not God.
Right.
But she didn't know that. Little Nazarene girl had a mother very dedicated to the Lord. That day, at 12 years of age, she received Jesus as her Lord and Savior, and all bitterness left her. But at 16 years of age, she was lying in bed one day, and Jesus walked right in her room. And he said to her, and I've heard people say, he couldn't have said that, but you got to go by the proofs in the pudding. Proof of the eating's in the pudding. Can you say amen? Jesus walked in the room and said, at 3:00 Sunday afternoon, I'm coming to your house to heal you. So she, and now I really understand why the Lord could have and would have said that. She tells her relatives, she tells her family, at 3:00 Sunday afternoon, Jesus told me, he came to my house, he walked in my room, and he told me he's going to make me whole. So at in the afternoon, Sunday afternoon, they bring her out on this chair. And they bring her into this room. Her room in her own chair that she had to be all propped up. And all of her relatives were there and their friends were there. And people were there because they'd heard Betty tell this fantastic story. They didn't know whether to believe it or not believe it. They didn't know if now her mind was being affected or what was going on. But let me tell you something interesting. She told her mother, she said, "Mama, go get me a new pair of shoes and a new dress. Because at 3 o'clock Sunday afternoon, I'm going to walk. I'm going to be normal." And there she is. She's in this room, and it strikes 3. A cloud filled the room, and they heard vertebrae, and the whole crowd heard the vertebrae in her back popping and snapping like popcorn. And all of a sudden, in just a moment, she was completely healed and stood upright on her feet and needed her dress and a new pair of shoes. Amen. He's a God of miracles. Hallelujah. And this is what's in my heart tonight. It's to say this to you. You don't have to live on what you got 20 years ago. You don't have to live on what you got 10 years ago. You don't have to live on what you got 1 year ago. You don't have to live on what you got 1 month ago. I know what the Word of God says, "Awake you who sleep, and Christ shall give you light. See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise." Hallelujah. "Be not drunk with wine like the world, but be being filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody in your heart to the Lord, and giving thanks." You all have already got the thanks part going here. You're a praising people. If I think of Waterloo Worship Center, I think of praise. Praise ye the Lord. Lift your hands up and praise Him.
Hallelujah.
And declare to Him, "I believe you're a God of miracles. I believe in you, Jesus. And I don't believe you just did miracles. Although I believe you did miracles, I believe you do miracles. And I come to you now, and I thank you for filling me afresh and anew with your Holy Spirit." I want you to notice that when the lame man was healed, they were filled with the Spirit. They'd already been filled on the day of Pentecost. Now this is years, 2, 3, 4 years. We don't know exactly how much longer, maybe 9 years. We're not sure the time frame, but we know it wasn't right then. And we know that Jesus came and worked miracles through people. And He did it based on one thing: you will receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. I've been in places where the power of God would fall. I remember that same place in Lima, Peru. I remember one night when I was coming down after I'd spoken to the Catholic priest. It was the next night or something after that. And I remember the Lord said to me, "Go down. Go down there again." And He said to me, "I'm going to hit them in clusters." I'd never heard anything like that before in my life. I didn't even know what it meant. And I walked down there, and so help me to the living God, it would be like a bomb would go off. There'd be 5 or 6 people around, and they'd just peel off. No catchers. Jeff and Ed were trying to catch. They couldn't catch. There was too much going on. They'd fall down themselves, jump up. The interpreter fell over. And finally, I tried to talk to her in the Spirit, and I said, "You know, I don't know any Spanish except hot tamales." She says, "Pastor, that is not Spanish." She had heard me speak in that language. She knew it was real. And she was touched by the Spirit of God. And you know Jeff, just a little old guy, he's about the size of David. Yeah. And this interpreter was quite large. And I looked up at one point, and all I see is Jeff's legs and his hands. And this lady had fallen over on top of him in the Spirit of the Lord. You can see some amazing things in church. But I'm telling you, the power of God fell. I'm telling you, the power of God fell. When they prayed, the place where they were assembled was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak the Word of God with boldness. Hallelujah. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Pour out of your Spirit. Hallelujah. Go ahead, do it this with me. Kambre sene, mambra disi, lora dange yan sorabute lara makayeta ramana. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm going to say to you, all freedom is in Jesus. Hallelujah. He is the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, and the God of glory. Harambese poranambre, noradunge jebata lefrepe kariene nambra. Thank you. Glory banzebre deya. Come on, come on. Let's give him praise. Let's give him praise. He's good. His mercy endures forever. He wants to do miracles for you. He wants to do miracles through you. Hallelujah. Just not in you, but through you. Hallelujah. Be being filled. Be being filled. Be being filled with the Holy Spirit. Right where you are, speak out in that heavenly language. Go ahead, David. Hallelujah. Shambra da mandale mono nombra nene. Come on, all of us. Let's be in one accord here tonight. Every now and then the Lord just leads me to just touch. 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 I'll say yes, Lord. Do you know that one?
Say yes, Lord. Yes.
To your will.
To your will and to your way.
I'll say yes.
I'll say yes, Lord, yes. I will trust you. And
when the Spirit speaks to me.
When the Spirit speaks to me.
With my whole heart.
With my whole heart.
And my answer.
And my answer will be yes.
What is it? What are you going to say when he says, I want to give you more Spirit. I want to fill you fuller. What are you going to say to him? Yes, Lord.
Yes.
Yes.
Lord,
yes.
Yes.
Go ahead.
To your will and to your way. I'll say yes.
I will trust you.
I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me.
With my whole heart.
With my whole heart I'll obey.
And you have.
And my answer will be, Lord, yes.
You know, sometimes our love for Jesus costs us other things. He'll protect us from going where we shouldn't go, being where we shouldn't be. He remembers every heart cry. And he does not pass us by. Oh, glory. Come on. There's a great flow in here. Just go ahead and just enter it. You say, don't look to me, look to him. I don't have anything except him, just like you do. We're in this together. That's right. Worshiping from your heart. Come on, Rabaranana. Sing in other tongues right now. Ha ha. Nambre sera tonare. Nambre rera non gene. Nambre lara non gene. Nombra rieto, nombra le, non c'è. Just lift your hands up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we give you honor. Father, we give you glory. We give you thanks for every life in this room, for every man, every woman, every teenage girl, every teenage guy, every child, every boy, every girl. We thank you. We thank you. Yes, we thank you for what you do. We thank you. Yes, we thank you. We thank you for everything you do. Lord, I magnify. And I lift up. Lord, I magnify you. Lord, I magnify you. Wonderful name. Lord, I magnify you. Young man, give me a hand. Other one. Lord, I magnify. He's a miracle-working God. Hallelujah. Lord, I magnify you.
Lord, I lift up your wonderful.
You know, I can't explain it, but all I know to tell you, sometimes I just feel like a string draws me to somebody. Just like I feel drawn to them. And you know that God is imparting something by His Spirit when you have that. It's real. This thing's real. Young man, it's real. It's so real. Give me a hand. It's real. Let Him touch you tonight. I'm not going to stand you up and embarrass you. We'll just let you sit right there and receive. It's not about me, it's about you. Come on. Impartations of the Holy Ghost. Say, what am I supposed to do if you come to me? Nothing. Just receive. You don't have to do anything but receive. Just receive. How do I do that? Just like you take a drink of water. You soak it in. You drink it down. I hear it this way, Lord, I yield to you. Lord, I yield to you. And I lift up. Lord, I yield to you.
Lord, I yield to you.
Lord, I yield to you. Father, increase your blessings on this precious man. Increase them, Lord. Increase them. He has a pure heart. He has a good heart. Increase. Increase them. Take somebody by the hand. Release what's in you into them. Go ahead, just right now. He's in all of us. He's in this whole crowd. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Everybody. It's for everybody. Peter stood up. They questioned him. He said, this promise is to you and to your children, your children's children, as many as are far off, as many as the Lord your God shall call. Have you been called? Have you been called to serve him? It's for you. Be being filled. Be being filled. Come on, this is a great place to be filled. Refill. This is how the Lord's been leading me lately, just to the whole crowd. Be being filled as a people. This is a higher realm than ministry, than just doing individual ministry. It's the whole crowd. It's everybody. It's for you and you and you. Turn to somebody and say, and you. And then say, for me. And begin to just worship him. Worship him a few minutes. We're not going to be here forever. Hey, little girl, what's your name? Aaliyah. That's a beautiful name. Bless her. Keep your hand on her. Let no harm or danger come to her. Jesus. Bless her. Bless her. Bless her. I command a blessing. Hallelujah. Jesus, you want to do a miracle in this body. You are the miracle worker. Jesus, I preached your word tonight. You said you would confirm your word. The signs that follow. Thank you. Thank you for it. Thank you for it. Burn. Burn, Bradini. Burn, Bradini. Majumbra Nangiana. In the nombre di. Thank you. Thank you, Master. Thank you, Master. Thank you, Master. I thank you. 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 I thank you, my Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad you came tonight just to get in the presence of Jesus? I long for the day that the church sees Jesus as the superstar and no man, just Jesus. Our eyes on Jesus, the author, the finisher of our faith. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Come on, give him praise. La Soramon Jarara Nambra Nene. Now, Father, I pray over this church, this house. And let me tell you something else, Brother Kevin, while I'm in the spirit. Some of the miracles he gives are buildings. He can give a building. I could stand here tonight and tell you miracle after miracle how God gave us buildings. They, everyone know it. It was amazing the miracles that God did, giving us buildings. This place is too small. Say with me, a building in one accord. A building we own. Hallelujah, that's ours. Yes! He'll give you a house. He'll give you a car. He'll give you a new body. He'll give you whatever you need. Hallelujah. just know the voice. Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, and they come at my call. If you want to see things happen, hear his voice. Wait in his presence until he speaks. And when he speaks, you don't have to make anything happen. You just let it happen because he's doing it. Glory to God. Come on, praise him. Praise him. We try to conjure up faith. Faith's not to be conjured. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When he speaks to you, you have faith. That's how it comes. The minute he speaks, faith comes with it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. This is wonderful.
Yes.
What a wonderful atmosphere. I could stay all night, but you got to go to work in the morning. It's 8:30. Lift your hands and give him praise, Pastor, as you come. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. Glory to God. Ah, yes. Stand up and praise him. Would you do that? Just give him praise. I love this house. If I lived here, this is where I'd go to church. I would. I love this house. Yes. Lambre sarabute kapanambre sula ravisti la namana nambradia. I would say this in my spirit. The things that you've struggled about internally, it only takes a moment. A moment. And a wind. A wind of the Spirit. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. One breath. I had a son, listen to this, who was on drugs, doing everything in the world, and I couldn't reach him. I'm going to stand up here like Brookie. Praise the Lord. You got to be a fool for Jesus sometimes. I couldn't do anything with him. I would look at him and devils would be jumping in his eyes. He was full of the devil. Why was he? Because he'd yielded to a wrong spirit. And my heart was broken. And the devil tried to run me out of the ministry saying, if you really, you don't have any business in the ministry with the way your son's doing. And I'd agree with him. Lord, I agree. But it wasn't the Lord. It was the enemy. And one night I was with two friends. We got over into prayer, and all of a sudden, the spirit of intercession came on me. Whew. And all of a sudden, I saw my son on his face, worshiping God. And 3 weeks later, what I saw became a reality. He is the mighty God. He will do what he said he would do. Hallelujah. Just love him and worship him and live for him, and he'll take care of your business. Praise God. Pastor's supposed to be dismissing, but